Donald Trump today calling Hillary Clinton a world-class liar. Clinton firing back, accusing Trump of pushing what she calls outlandish lies and conspiracy theories. I want to talk about this and a lot more with Tavis Smiley, the host of PBS's Tavis Smiley and the author of a new book called Before You Judge Me, The Triumph and Tragedy of Michael Jackson's Last Days. I can't wait to read this.
Thank you.
It's a departure for you.
Yeah.
We'll talk about that. Okay. But I want to talk about the scathing speech today that Donald Trump gave this morning about Hillary Clinton. What'd you think?
I didn't see the speech. I've heard about it. It's par for the course. It's going to be this way from now until November. I wish, and I don't know why we can't figure out a way to do this like other countries do, like in like 3 months and be done with it. Of course, CNN loves this protracted. You love this, don't you? Don't you love this protracted campaign?
I have to say this is one of the most unique and unusual campaigns I've ever been involved with. We both covered. We were there for 2008. Mm-hmm. And that was historic because there was, you know, the first black man to be in the White House. But this is something just beyond, don't you think?
Yeah, I think this election is fundamentally, Don, about what kind of country we're going to be, who we are really as a people. In many ways, America has grown older, but we've not grown wiser. We've grown older, but not grown up. Mm-hmm. And the fact that we're dealing with these kinds of sophomoric issues in this campaign, I think says something not just about the candidates, but about the people. And so we're going to see what the American people have to say about what kind of nation we really want to be. The ideals that we profess as a country have to be squared with the ideas that are being promulgated in this campaign. Yeah. And I don't see how you square some of this stuff.
Well, let's talk about the people, because he has said many things that have offended many groups, and yet and still he says, I'm going to get their votes. Is that how it usually works?
That's not quite how it works in my book. When you push an agenda that is antithetical to the best interest of the people that you think are going to vote for you, then you're delusional. And I think there are any number of examples where I think Mr. Trump is not just hyperbolic, but indeed delusional.
Well, you were here and you called him a racial arsonist, and I went.
And I was right, wasn't I?
Yeah. So what do you think?
I was right. That's what I think. let me just say that when I said that, it was clear to me that Donald Trump was going to use a scorched earth strategy if that's what it required to win this nomination, and indeed he did. But now we have to come to terms with the stuff that he's saying and who the real Donald Trump is. What I'm tired of hearing, and I've said this before, I guess, what I'm tired of hearing, though, Don, is that this is not the Donald that I know. I still can't square the Donald that we see on the news on CNN every night with all these people who are in his inner sanctum saying, but that's not who Donald really is. I mean, I've talked to all his friends, not all of them, but many of his friends are friends of mine. Mm-hmm. I'm like, well, who's the real guy? And nobody can answer that question.
He is different in person. Listen, I don't know him.
You've been with him a lot, though.
I've been with him, and he, in person, he is completely different than that person that you see up on stage or behind that podium.
So what do you make of that?
Is he
a phony?
No, what I make of it is that I think he wants to win.
Yeah.
And I've said that before. I think he wants to win.
At all cost?
And he wants to win. Let's put it that way. So a lot of black people out there lean conservative. You know that, right? Yeah. Do you think that, and you know, he says that he can win the black vote. Mm-hmm. Do you think that Donald, his efforts, and what he says with his, you know, diversity coalition, do you think that'll work? Do you think he will get some black folks or a significant amount?
Here again, I think this is another example of his delusion. I love when black voters are in play. I am tired of the Democratic Party taking black folk for granted. I am tired of the Republican Party, Donald, completely ignoring African Americans, as it were. But you have to push an agenda, again, that considers their concerns and their issues. And when the numbers indicate that they don't just, here's the thing, the numbers that I read indicate not just that he isn't going to get their vote, but that they don't like him. His negatives are high across the country, as we well know. But his negatives amongst African Americans are extremely high. And I don't know how you keep suggesting that you're going to get their
vote. The blacks love him, though.
Yeah, I know, the blacks. And there's his, my African American is over there. I mean, I don't know how you think that kind of language.
Was that offensive to you?
I mean, I'm at the point now where I'm almost not offended by anything that comes out of his mouth. I expect anything and everything to be said by him, to your point, in an effort to win this election. So there's nothing that he says on, I mean, it's great for ratings, but when I hear him every day, there's almost nothing he says now that surprises me.
Let's talk about Hillary Clinton.
Sure.
Elizabeth Warren's name has been floated around. What do you think? Do you like it?
Not going to happen. Not going to happen. That's my assessment. I mean, what do I know? I'm not inside the campaign. Here's my argument, or my thesis, at least, that when you're rolling the dice on trying to be the first woman president, and let me just say very quickly that I'm tired of all the chest beating that we're doing in this country about electing perhaps the first woman. I love Hillary. She's my girl. But we're like way down the line of countries who've done this. You do realize that, right?
Yeah,
there are folk around the world who've elected women time and time again.
Like America, when are you going
to
do it?
We're acting like, as always, American exceptionalism. We're about to elect a woman. So it's a big deal, but it's not that big a deal on the world stage. Having said that, I think when you're trying to do something historic, you don't roll the dice on trying to be the first woman and put another woman on your ticket. Now, I have nothing against that. Elizabeth Warren is certainly qualified.
Yeah.
But I think the patriarchy and the sexism in our country, I think, has to be considered. Would Barack Obama have picked a black person to run with him? And that's my point.
Okay.
Yeah.
Before you judge me, the triumph and tragedy of Michael Jackson's last days. Why did you decide to write this? You said it's a departure, but maybe not such a departure.
Because I'm a fan of Michael like everybody else was. Yeah, and in my case, I grew up in Indiana. Michael's from Indiana. And I had already got my tickets, my concert tickets, my plane ticket, hotel reservations to go to London. I was going to be there for this first show. 16 weeks after he makes the announcement, I'm coming back one more time, this is it, he's dead. And I wanna know what happened between the time you made a commitment to come back and why didn't you make it back on the stage? So we reconstruct, we put together a map really of the last 16 weeks of his life so you can be in the space with him to see what that journey was like. I started with a simple question, why are you gone too soon? When I got into the research, Don, my question did a 180 on me. It wasn't why are you gone too soon, it's how did you survive this long once I saw all that he was going through.
I remember being out there in L.A. and you were part of our coverage as well, and I remember you being on the scene for Michael Jackson's death, and then I'm sure you saw the funeral on CNN or wherever it was. What went wrong? What do you think happened in the end?
Barry Gordy put it to me this way, that sometimes these iconic figures become rudderless. And when you're not anchored to something and you become unmoored, you start drifting.
Like Whitney.
You start drifting. And I think that's part of what happened. But I would also be the first to tell you that as surely as Michael made bad choices and mistakes and bad decisions, which only makes him human, greed also played a hand in Michael's death because everybody wanted to get their hooks into him. Mm-hmm. So it's a cautionary tale. To be careful what you ask for on the one hand. On the other hand, we've got to find a way to move beyond looking at these stars exclusively through their iconography, which I think obscures our ability to get to their humanity. And I want to get to the humanity of Michael Jackson.
And I'm sure you do in this book. I can't wait to read it. Before you judge me, the triumph and tragedy of Michael Jackson's last days. Mr. Tavis Smiley, always a pleasure.
Mr. Don Lemon, thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. We'll be right back.